She-Hulk, who's dying and needs blood, a blood transfusion. There needs to be new blood in the industry. Otherwise, it's going to become literally doomsday. Destroying itself and everyone around them. So, anyway, that's my little rant of the comics industry and stuff. So anyway, today's episode basically is we're doing the Dark Knight Rises, how I would have made it. What if it was done this way? So, for those who, of course, seen Dark Knight Rises, if you remember in the film, Bruce Wayne, Batman, has disappeared from Gotham City, basically retired. And for those who, of course, know, like, before the film was made, Heath Ledger, of course, passed away. And there was no Joker in the film. So, what if none of that happened? What if Ledger never really died? If I would have done Batman the way it should have been, I would have had basically Bane still in it, Joker, more of a supporting Hannibal Lecter type character. If you've seen Silence of the Lambs, Dr. Lecter is in the, you know, prison giving advice to Jodie Foster's character to catch Buffalo Bill. You know, if you've never seen that, it's a good film, but it's very unsettling, is what the film is. So, Bane in this story is, instead of Talia al Ghul being in it, you know, because fuck her, who needs Talia in the film? She's boring. She's a boring character. Bane in this story is the son of Ra's al Ghul, who, in this story, he, of course, is trained by the League of Shadows. He sort of, in a fight, gets his face disfigured and messed up by a brutal fight to prove his loyalty to his father, Ra's. And Ra's gets mad at him and sends him to the pit. We still get all that. We get the pit and all that. So, in this story, Bruce is, of course, retired. He's sort of watching Gotham. Joker is in prison. The one thing that always bugged me with the Dark Knight Rises, and I love the film. I love everything about it. It's a great film. Fuck Talia. I'm glad she died in that film. So, Bruce has sort of been, instead of like frozen in time where he's, you know, retired and he's frozen in time over the death of Rachel and all that, that kind of always bugged me. And this one, he sort of moves on. He sort of moves on with his life. Alfred didn't burn the letter in The Dark Knight. Instead, he kept the letter to give to Bruce. So Bruce decides, I'm going to move on with my life. Rachel? Oh, fuck her. Catwoman? Yep. That's kind of how it would go. So, I always hated that. Like, that always bugged me, the frozen in time thing. But instead, Bruce decides to retire after the fall, where him and Harvey fell and, you know, and all that. He decides to retire because he hurt his back. And he's like, I'm going to quit being Batman for a while. So he moves on. It's It's kind of like Dark Knight Rises. He just moves on with his life, and he meets Selina, and they hook up, and all that, basically. I kind of wanted to focus on that. The romance between Batman and Catwoman kind of felt like it got pushed aside. It felt like it was a last-minute thing in Dark Knight Rises. That always bugged me. Like, they should have sort of had the chemistry. So in this one, Catwoman works for Bane. Bane arrives in Gotham, and he knows who Catwoman is. So he gets Catwoman to work for him by holding her sister hostage. In this one, Selina is sort of stealing stuff, not to survive, but to provide for her sister who is dying of cancer. So, one night she just hears about this job by her friend, who is sort of like a computer tech guy who can crack the systems and all that for her to go in and steal and stuff. Kind of like Leverage. If you've ever seen Leverage, I don't know if anyone has ever seen Leverage. So she ends up going to this place, but she finds out he set her up. And she meets Bane. And Bane shows her photographs of her sister, that he's been keeping an eye on them. He knows what she's been doing. So he goes like, you have to work for me to get Bruce Wayne's fingerprints. In this one, Bane's motivation is to prove his father wrong. That he can destroy Gotham. Something that Ra's can never do. That's always something I always thought, like, that would have been much better if Bane was like the son of Ra's instead of the protector of Talia. That always bugged me, because it kind of made Bane look a bit of a softy, like, in my opinion. Like, I like the mercenary, highly intelligent Bane. So in this one, Bane decides that he's going to do something that his father never could have done. Destroy Gotham. So she ends up stealing the fingerprints from Bruce at the party that, of course, Gordon is celebrating the dent thing. She shows up. She sneaks into the manor, takes the fingerprints, and sort of has this remorse of, but in a way that makes it interesting is, she gets herself on the camera, security cameras, instead of usually being slick and past the cameras and all that. She does it as a way to send a message to Bruce that something's up. I always thought that'd be pretty easy and cool to sort of have that cool moment of something's up. So, in this one, she does another job for Bane. When he gets the fingerprints of Bruce, he gets the bomb that destroys Gotham and all that. She ends up letting out the Joker. Which I always felt like it kind of bugged me with the original Dark Knight, the Dark Knight Rises, that they never referenced the Joker. Like, they never mentioned a Joker. I know there's going to be some people like, well, Nolan did it out of respect of Ledger, but it's like, when you watch The Dark Knight Rises, it's like, you got to see Two-Face. You got to see, like, the glimpse of Two-Face. You got to see Rachel and a photograph. I don't know why. That was kind of like, and it's not really a photograph that you look at and it's like, that's something Bruce Wayne took. It's like, that's just a still image from from Dark Knight at a dinner table, at the double date dinner between Rachel and Harvey and Bruce and, I don't even know what the chick's name was. She was annoying, though. So, anyway. Joker in this one is sort of, he's older, like Bruce. But the fun thing I always wanted to see was, Selina goes to Arkham. She has to go underground in the asylum. Because in this one, they put Joker underground. Like, she overhears guards talking about the Joker. That they had to remove everything in his cell. The bed, the pillow cover, the pillow covers and sheets and stuff, because Joker would assault guards. Like, he would fuck them up. Like, he would brutalize them. And one guard's like, that he took a plastic fork and ripped the eye, took the eyes out of a victim. Like, I always thought that I wanted to see Joker as sort of like this menacing, disturbed person, like, or, not rip the eyes out, but carve a smile on their face, you know. So, she goes to the cell. She looks inside the cell and sees Ledger's Joker standing in the middle of the room looking at her and calls her Kitty. And he sort of makes this funny remark towards her that there's a cat, where's the bat? Sort of funny joke, I don't know. Couldn't come up with the lines, but there was like one part I really always wanted to see was Joker as the judge instead of Crane. So, anyway, she ends up letting the Joker out of the cell and out of Arkham. The reason of it is it's part of Bane's plan. He wants to put Joker as an obstacle, but Joker meets Bane, which kind of makes it really cool in this moment where she takes the Joker to Bane and Joker gets his stuff. And Bane tries to give him an order of, you have to give anarchy to Gotham to keep Batman occupied. And Joker sort of looks at him, and he has like this expression of like, you don't give me orders, because the last time someone ever gave me orders, I got scars for it. Which sort of hints at Joker as a military person, which I always thought that. It would have been really interesting, though. There's sort of like this interesting story that Joker tells Bane. So, and it Batman finds out Joker's been let out. But the cool thing about it was it jumps to a flashback. I know Nolan films, they really don't do flashback scenes, but instead, Gordon reads part of the journal that he kept. He always kept a journal. I decided to add that part to it where there's a lot you can do with these stories. There is. So in this journal, Gordon and Batman takes Joker to Arkham after the entire Dent thing. I know this is weird, some people are like, that doesn't make sense. How did Batman escape from the cops and all that? But in this one, it sort of reveals how Batman can pop up everywhere. Remember in Batman Begins where Alfred tells Bruce that there's been tunnels underneath Gotham and Wayne Manor and all that? Batman uses those tunnels to travel to places. Like, how do you think he showed up at the bank? During the bank robbery thing in the beginning of Dark Knight. So in this one, Bruce and Gordon puts the Joker in this cell where it's revealed that only they know where Joker is being kept, along with the guards that are being paid as private contractors to